Hey, Earl.
Oh my God, Earl.
Hi, this is Doug and Kate Jackson with SVSeeker.com, and we are building this big steel boat, and my partner, Kay, has been a great help on it, but now she's running away to Mexico. Her drugs, she has fibromyalgia, and her drugs have finally gotten tuned in, and the yoga and the exercise, and she's done
meditation.
Good taking care of herself, so she's running off to Mexico to enjoy the Mayan, and it's actually one of our future sailing sites. So she'll be gone for 5 months. I'll be a bachelor.
Yes, you will.
And tell them what you're going to do when you get back.
When I get back, I'm going to start school for occupational therapy assistant. I was a school teacher for 26 years, so this is different for me, but I'm done grading papers in the evening.
Yeah. So and it works around the pain levels that she experiences too, so it's a good deal for her. I'm happy for it, but I'm kind of bummed because I'm losing the person that helps me with the boat. So this video is about getting you to come help me work on the boat. I've had people come in to work on the boat for, you know, a day, 3 days, even a week, and I really enjoyed that. I learned a lot from it, and I hope it's a good experience for you. And there's people that, you know, maybe you're thinking about building one, maybe you just want to weld some steel, maybe you want to be a part of this adventure, and that invitation is for you. Let me show you the boat a little bit. Yeah, let's start from up here. This hull was designed by Jack Karsten. It's an origami hull, which means it started off life as big flat sheets of steel, and then it had long darts cut in it. You can see where the chines are. That's where the darts were, one there and then one down where the keel attaches. And the whole thing was folded together to take the shape of half a boat. Do that twice, weld the two together, you got a boat. It's a design that you'll find a lot of information about from Brent Swain. And I actually asked Brent to design the boat for me, do the lines for it, and he didn't want to do that. He really doesn't like big boats. He kind of thinks you're never going to finish them. And, maybe not, but, you know, that's what I want to do. Jack Karsten did it for me, and he did one another one up in Vancouver Island. Paul's boat is up there, and Paul's much further along than I am. So origami is a fast way of getting the hull together, but after that you still got a lot of work to do. There's the side decks have been placed onto it. So here we are down inside, and this is the bulkhead that was put in after the hull was pulled together. These longitudinals are actually on the hull when it's pulled together, as well as the top pipe outside. And then we put on our mermaid deck stiffeners, and the side decks went on. That was after those. And now we're working on the cargo hold, which is going to be where the fuel tanks are all going to be. These are the partitions for those. And when we go back to work, that's what we're going to be doing. There'll be, this is a cargo hold area, so there's a cabin forward of us for 4 to 6 guests, and there's an engine room behind us. Let me go up top and I'll show you the sections. So from up here, I can show you where the companionway will be, or a staircase that goes from this deck down through this bulkhead into the forward cabin, and the sole or the floor of the cabin will be about 6 inches above those yellow lines down there. So it's kind of roomy by boat standards anyway. Up here is the forepeak, and there'll be a mast that'll come up from down in there and lean forward. This is a Chinese junk design. And then this deck will be raised a little bit, and then there'll be bulwarks added onto here that are steel, basically the boat coming on up with another pipe to stiffen all this. Now a lot of that has to be done after we're at the port, because we have to clear power lines to get from here to the water, which is 18 miles away. More on that in a bit. Here's the back bulkhead. There'll be another opening there for you to go through the bulkhead, and there'll be another companionway coming down from this deck through this bulkhead and into the cargo hold. There's our engine room. Engine will sit where the bottom of that ladder is. Transmission, and that's just going to be a school bus engine and transmission, automatic transmission. That box controls the Hundersted, the controllable pitch propeller system. We have videos on that. And then there's another bulkhead, and it goes back through that hatch into an aft cabin. Real small cabin, not much room, but a quiet place to get away and something small that might be able to be air conditioned. So now we're down inside the engine room, and you can see the back of the keels there. And there's that control box. There's the tube where the drive shaft comes through for the engine, and I'll give you a peek back into there even though it's dark. That's the rudder post back in the back there, and this is the water entry into the skeg for the cooling that acts like our radiator for the boat. So that's not a very large room, but built pretty much just like the rest of the boat here. Very good. You ready to get out now? Up here, all of this area is the pilot house. It'll have an aluminum structure around it, and that's the place where we'll mainly live. There'll be a galley there. There'll be a head on the back deck. There'll be a shower back there. There'll be the helm and control station. This is the main part of the boat. And so looking forward, we got 70, oh, and it's still bouncy on the deck, so we haven't welded the stiffeners onto the deck plate here. But it's 74 feet from stem to stern here. And our cranes were actually one of the first things that we put up. There's our gantry cranes. They stand about, I think they're 21 feet tall. Yeah, 21 feet, that's to the top of them, because those are 20-foot beams going up. And they have been served wonderful. They've been wonderful to have. That's all of our steel down there and the pipe. That'll be more top railing for us, and we use pipe for stiffening and bracing and other things around the work yard. Most of that's quarter-inch steel. Those sheets are 6 feet wide and 45 feet long. That's what we got. And the blue ones there are some of our beams for lifting things. Spreader beams. This is galvanized steel, and this pile here is all 3/16. That'll be the cabin tops. The cabin tops are what's going to fill over this area here. Everything will come up about, we haven't really decided. It's all, play it by ear, but probably about 18 inches, and it'll be covered over, and there'll be portals down the sides of these. We also have portals to go into the side of the ship that are brass that we picked up last year. We're looking forward to putting those in. Give us some ventilation down inside. And here's that skeg out from the outside. That's actually our radiator. And it comes down to a point here in front of the shroud for our propeller. And that protects our propeller and also gives us a little more thrust. And we got a big old rudder hanging out here. It's a fishtail rudder. She weighs 1,000 pounds of rudder here, and she's hollow inside. So she displaces about 600 pounds of water. So she weighs 400 pounds when she comes off in the water. And let's see, then we got a twin keel design on this boat, which means, one keel on both sides. Some nice things about that. There's some disadvantages too, but the nice thing is you can get a nice shallow draft because we have wings on our keels that we added on. So all of our lead will be down low, and that gives us center of gravity that's lower without incurring a lot more draft on the boat. So we're hoping we can get away with a 6-foot draft on this boat. Yeah, it's a hope. Anyway, I don't want to do any more than that because you really have trouble getting into shallow waters, places in the Bahamas. But two of them also give you the ability to pull up into a bay that has a nice tidal zone into it. Let the tide go out, the boat sits on the bottom upright just like it is now, and you can come out and clean the underside of your boat and just a lot of your maintenance yourself and not incur the cost of a haul out. This is Jezebel. Say hello, Jezebel.
Hi.
Now she's a Chinese junk, which means she gets this flat bow on her and that big flat transom on the rear end. And so this is where our anchors are going to be. Remember also those bulwarks are going to come up here on the side, so she has that opened up look out here on her. And her design is nice. She's not a yacht. She's a work boat. We don't really care about the pretties and the fancies and the shiny stuff. We want this boat to be an expedition boat, an exploration boat, an adventure boat. And we don't want to worry about, people wearing black shoes and scuffing up our white decks. All that stuff, we just don't care about. We want to be able to take on tools and equipment and do what we wish without incurring the penalty of having to look good. Our methods kind of incur wanting to be able to build everything that we have and build it in a method that we can build it on a beach somewhere if we have to. This is our anchor design, and it's a spade anchor, and it actually comes apart. The yoke here has a bolt. It slides in from the bottom, so you can take that bolt out and you can take it back out, lay it all flat. So we'll have start off with four of those at least. We got three others in the process. Our tools are as homey as you can possibly get. This is a winch underneath there that we use for dragging steel around the pad. And everything else is kind of like that. We simplify things as much as possible. We have an air compressor over there that has every safety device in the world removed from it. So it just provides air. It's salvaged from a fire. We have a school bus.
We got two of them, actually. This is the second one. This one we bought because of the engine out of it. And then we turned the rest of it into a storage shed until we're done. That's our, we have propane tanks in there and our oxygen tank and CO2 tank for welding. All the battens for our sails are here. All the aluminum sheet for a tender that we're gonna build is all here. Pipe rack got used. It has some stainless steel pipe up there for handrails. We try and do as much as we can cheaply. There's another one of those things that we built for ourselves. It's a sandblast pot. It actually uses household water pressure to deliver the sand to the airstream, which is provided by that compressor. And this beast here is our crane. This is actually going to go on our deck. She'll lift, 1,000 pounds at full extension of 20 feet. So that will get mounted up in one of the corners of the cabin tops for all kinds of things, whatever we want to do with it. Putting a boat over the side, putting ROVs over the side, you name it. We got the work crane. Here's our anchor winch. We rebuilt this from a common winch, and she's got a worm drive gear on her, and she'll be hydraulic powered. We'll have hydraulics on the boat for not only for the crane and this, but for probably a bow thruster eventually. I know people keep saying, you gotta put a bow thruster on that. Well, come on down and help me put a bow thruster on it. Here's our foremast. It might be our main mast, but we actually want a little bit bigger one for our main mast. But it's a utility pole. It's galvanized steel, and it's 43 feet long. And here's our diesel engine and transmission. We're going to run with the automatic Allison transmission right on the back of our school bus engine, which is a Cummins. It's as simple of a diesel as you can possibly get. And we fire her up every couple of months just to make sure she stays running well. We're happy with that. And, you know, it could give us problems running an automatic transmission out of, yes, it could, but we're also a sailboat. I can replace a $600 transmission with $600. You can replace a twin disc transmission, or you have to acquire one with $15,000. So there's that's pretty much our philosophy there. If you can get by with it cheaper, do so. And we're not afraid of a little work. This that you're looking at is a pile of lead that is 30,000 pounds, 15 tons. K&I collected this by going out once a month and getting tire wheel weights and melting them down and pouring them into ingots. Some of it came in from hospitals, but most of this is lead weights from your car tires, which is a lot of lead weights. And our shed in the backyard here has a lot of our supplies and stuff, things that go boom, stay back here if they can. That first school bus, all of those up there are the windows out of it. Those are gonna be the windows in our pilot house. This is also where our compressor stays because it's noisy. We grow strawberries and blackberries. We've had gardens before and done other things, but they take too much time. These are the cash crops and we just love them. Here's our solar tank. We relax by the fireplace in the winter, and the fireplace has a tank above it for heating water. We love our hot tub. It's actually not a hot tub. It's for the summer, we like keeping cool water in it. Here's our watertight doors that we made to go through our bulkheads. And as you can see, we get a little bit fanciful and artful every once in a while. Hi, how you doing?
I'm here in the pond.
Okay.
Can come over here?
Yeah, that's fine. They can come over and play in the pond. These are our portals that we picked up at an auction. These are our propeller blades that we've cast. We made them. The drive shaft and hub we bought up in Vancouver from Paul, because he had two of them. He's got another one if you want one. Those are the blades that will run our system. And I said they're controllable pitch, which means these blades actually hydraulically can be changed in their angle of attack to the water, which works great on a sailboat. We can turn them so that they don't have much drag and sail along and incur a penalty for that big blade. Quick tour of the shop. Oh, you came in to relax in the shade. We're jammed in the shop, but we get a lot done in here. We've got a couple of different benches. They're all covered with different projects right now. We're working heavily on an ROV, and the ROV to me is the boat, and the boat is the ROV. So people say, when are you gonna go back and work on the boat? Well, I am working on the boat, because this is the purpose of the boat, is to do underwater research and to facilitate that, diving, salvage, all those type of things. I just don't want to be out sailing a boat from one bar to the next. That's not what I want to do at all. We want to work the work boat. And so having the proper tools is part of the deal. So we have, you know, our vacuum chambers and electronic equipment to test with. I picked up some machine, actually this isn't machine wax, this is casting wax from a local foundry that's helping me out doing some casting. So we're looking forward to trying that out. all the parts for the ROV. My laptop lives out here. Let's see, I got a beautiful lathe that people have come in, and I learned from guests that come in. I really don't know anything about a lathe when I bought one, but I do a little bit now, and it is a wonderful tool. Let's see, our welders, we've got an Iron Man. We've got a Longevity down there. We've got a Lincoln out on the pad. Here's the welder I use a lot. It's a Miller 12VS, it's a suitcase welder. And I love MIG. I know there's a lot of people out there, oh, you ought to be using stick. Well, you know, it's probably because you use stick and I don't, I use MIG, sorry, okay? That's it. Our tanks, we use propane for heating, but I don't hardly ever cut with this. Most of the time we use the plasma torch. Let me show you that. There's the Hobart Iron Man. I use that for MIG in the shop and also for running a spool gun back here for doing aluminum welding. And that's actually where I started out, is using this a lot. And for cutting, I don't use a torch. I use this Hypertherm PowerMax 1000. And it is, man, I tell you what, it's getting old and beat up, but I still love this machine. I mean, nothing cuts steel like that thing does. Sandblast cabinet, use it a little bit for cleanup parts, you know, various wheels on the bench here for grinding and sharpening tools and so forth. And back in here, this is our CNC room. And we have a CNC table in here that we went up to Kansas City and bought one. I actually built the room intending to put a CNC in it, but I didn't think it'd be one this big. But this has really turned out to be a wonderful table. It'll take a full 4x8 sheet and cut the whole thing for you. It came with a router on it, but the rest of all the drive controls and motors were all in pieces, and we've rebuilt it twice now, but it's been great because we've not only can do our routing work here, but we can drag that table forward, fill it with water, that pan, and I've got another one so I can do more of the table with the grid on top of it. I can cut steel with a plasma torch, add it onto here, and just recently we added 3D printing to it too, so we can do that now. Now, we also have an apartment onto this end of the building, and it has its own air conditioner, a ladder up to a loft, and a little bathroom in here. Jezebel, what are you doing in here? You should be in here. You're in the air conditioning. Get out. Go on. Go on. Good girl. So if you come and work with us, we'll be sure to put you up someplace. But yeah, you got to check with me, though, before you just show up, because sometimes the apartment's occupied. And we love our neighbor in our neighborhood, and because we've got kids that Aiden can play with. Let's see, what else we got? Beautiful garden. I think that's it. You've seen, this is our operation. And so if you want to be a part of our adventure, or you think that you can learn something by dropping by, or especially if you think you can teach me something, you are welcome to come. Give me a holler. Now the question we get asked so many times is, how are you going to get that monstrosity to the ocean? Because you've really figured out we live in Tulsa, Oklahoma, in the heartland of the United States.
It's a valid question.
It is a valid question. And I didn't even know when I moved here that this is the most inland seaport in the United States. There's a waterway all the way up to us. It starts off just 15 miles from here at the Port of Catoosa. It's called the Tulsa Port of Catoosa if you want to look it up. You go down the Verdigris River, then you drop into the Arkansas, and then 400 miles down the Arkansas, you drop into the Mississippi, and then 600 miles down the Mississippi, you come to New Orleans. So we're only 1,000 miles from the Gulf of Mexico. It's a little simple trip.